Welcome back to QuadJacks Poker Radio. I am so happy to be joined by both Matt Glantz, the Honorable Matt Glantz, and the Dishonorable Alan Bari.
Wow.
No, I don't mean that. I do not mean that at all.
Good start.
Honorable from my end.
Thanks so much, guys, for coming. I hope you're feeling well. Mr. Glantz, you are a professional poker player. Former trader, I believe.
Correct.
Former trader turned poker player, very successful. Tell us about some of your more prominent poker achievements or successes. Did you ever win anything?
Poker achievements, I guess the biggest, I guess tournaments are what we're talking about, because cash games are, you know, dime a dozen, you win every day.
Yeah, those are not achievements.
Okay. So poker achievements, we'll say, I guess the biggest tournament I won was in London, the EPT High Roller event, which was it was a 25,000 euro buy-in at the time, so I guess, or 25,000 pounds or euro, I'm not sure, it was $33,000 at the time, and I won that.
Wasn't it probably pounds?
I forget if it was euros or pounds. It was part of the EPT, so whatever they use. It was the only time I was ever out there. Mm-hmm. I went to Europe one time, won the event, and came home, and it was a tough final table. Eugene, a good friend of mine, came in third, Eugene Kachalov, and Eric Cagelet, I beat heads up, so that was fun. That was for like, that score was like $830,000 or something like that, dollars.
Awesome.
So that was cool. And then I've had a lot of close encounters to winning, but a lot of good second, third, fourth place in big events, like the 50K mixed game championship at the World Series. I final tabled that twice. I think I came in fourth and fifth. So those were big scores, probably close to $400,000 each time.
Well done. You are qualified.
Qualified to be on QuadJacks.
And Mr. Bari, you are a bracelet winner.
I am a bracelet winner.
Bracelet winning, Alan Bari. Tell us more about your poker history and background.
Let's see. I started playing poker when I was 11. Mm-hmm. Started out playing like weird games like six card stud high low, crisscross, all sorts of weird games. Started playing no limit in college. I played on party poker, and then I played in underground cash games. Like 1-2 and 2-5.
Where was this again?
It was in New Brunswick, because I went to Rutgers University. So, New Brunswick, New Jersey. Then I graduated. I started working in finance, and I was playing part-time poker. When I first worked at AIG, every Friday I would leave work at 12, and I would play 5-10 no limit all weekend.
Please allow me to give Mr. Glantz a dirty look.
I will be turning it off.
I put mine on vibrate. So yeah, I played no limit, and then I got laid off from my second job at Morgan Stanley, and I used my severance package, which was going to be a lot higher than my bonus because I didn't do shit there. And I used that to cushion my bankroll, and then I got offered a tournament backing deal. By Matt Brady and David Fox. Mm-hmm. This was January of 2008. And then I, 2 weeks later, I won the Venetian tournament for, 96,000, or I chopped it actually forehand at 96,000. Then I had a really good 2008. And then, that summer I won the Borgata for, it says $500,000, but I chopped it for like 350.
Okay.
So that was my first very large score. But in 2008, I pretty much had like a 100K score every month or two.
And this year you won a bracelet.
And this year I won a bracelet.
In?
A 5K full ring.
5K full ring. Oh, I'm sorry, I brought it with you today.
No, it is, my mom has it.
Why are you guys both disrobing at the same time?
Is this the interrogation room?
What is that? Well, what is this?
I was going to take it off, but then Matt took his off, and I was like, all right. I'll just follow
this. This is not that kind of show. I know there's video. Well, but it might actually regress into that kind of show. Well, congratulations.
Thank
That's
you.
Pretty awesome. What do you do with the bracelet, Mike?
I honestly just put it in a safe in my mom's house.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well done. Well, gentlemen, you're both very qualified, and you two know each other.
Yes.
Now, I know I asked you this in the past when you were both on this program. When was it? That was during the Poker's Court. That was the first time we had both of you guys on the program.
Feels about 2 or 3 months ago, I guess.
Wasn't that long?
Feels like it, yeah.
Okay. Have you considered a judgeship or you know, a career in in law ever since? Or?
No, I think we're just all friends. I mean, we were playing. His court case was against Sean Deeb, and we were actually playing poker, all three of us, last night together at the IRA. We're all
joking
around. There's no animosity between those guys.
Really?
We're all good friends. They just like to kid
around. Sean has some animosity towards me.
Who does?
Sean.
Sean does have some animosity
towards me. I mean, it's a joking animosity, but I think that night when we were playing 300, 600 at Aria, and he challenged me to some form of heads up about six times.
Really?
It was just absurd. I don't know. I don't know what his deal is. I like Sean overall, but he just gets a little out of line sometimes.
He just likes seeing Al and get a little buzz from it. So I've talked to Sean numerous times about it, and he has no animosity towards Al.
No, okay. It's just an act.
Supposedly.
Yes.
All right, I guess he likes to push my buttons then.
Yeah, that's how it's like tough love, man. That's how he likes to show his love.
He plays ladies only events, so it's okay.
Oh, okay. Who said that?
Rob
Mathias. Rob, I beg you to mind yourself. You guys are in town. Why?
We're here. Last week was the Bellagio event.
So it was?
It was the WPT Bellagio, and then two days from now, we start the Epic, the third Epic event, which is the Mixed Max event. So that's a big one.
Your final table. The last one.
Wow.
No, your final one. I'm sorry, you bubbled the last one. Jeez.
You got pretty cool out of the bubble last time.
Oh, wow. I mean, I'm unqualified.
Was that a needle or did
that
you?
Was not a needle.
That was not intentional.
I thought it was came in ninth.
I got 13th, but yeah, keep going.
13th? What?
Yeah.
Okay.
12 cash and I got 13th.
Oh, 12 cash, okay. The final table was made up by eight people.
Yeah.
And I thought you bubbled the final table.
No, I bubbled the cash.
Oh, yeah, my 12, you're bubbling, I don't know.
That was good.
I'm so sorry, Alan. I'm sorry. You did not final table the Epic. You did not even cash.
No, I didn't.
You bubbled it.
I actually got needled the next day. Joanne Prim from Epic, she texted me saying, it was like 11:30, or maybe 1 o'clock, and the final table starts at 2, and she goes, shuffle up and deal, almost time, Alan. When the final table of the Epic that I bubbled was going on, I go, what? And she was like, oh, sorry, wrong text.
I'll tell you what happened. It was funny, that event. There was 15 players left, only 12 cash. It's a kind of big bubble. I think the bubble was like $40,000.
Mm-hmm.
So me and Alan usually spot 5% before the tournament starts, and we're playing the same tournament. So this one, there were 15 left, and Alan and I were out of 15. I think we were 14th and 15th in chips, so we were real low.
Mm-hmm.
So either of us go out any time. So we're just like, we decided to swap an extra 5%. So now we have a 10% swap of each other with 15 left. By the time it got down to 13 left, Alan was second in chips, and I was still last in chips. So I was like, wow, this is a great swap. I'm so happy. I'm like, kind of cheering for Alan. He's doing good, and now, you know, he has a chance to win it. Well, don't worry, from 13 to 12, he was going to bust it. So. he got in a tough spot. He tried to outplay Dutch Boyd in a hand where Dutch flopped top set of kings and a king queen 3-board.
Right.
And I know Alan regrets it, but at the time he thought it was the right play. It was a very ballsy play. Not many players can make the move there. But
how did you ultimately fare in the same tournament?
Like, I think I know,
but I don't want to embarrass myself any further.
I came in 12th,
so
like
you're
almost
the
like,
one who cashed it, not even final table.
Right, no final table. I've been known to come in 12th a lot lately, the last 4 or 5 months.
Turns out I made the good swap.
Yeah, so he actually made the good swap. So he bubbled and I cashed. I guess it was somewhere around 40,000 for that one.
46,000 was it? Yeah.
Was that big?
Yeah.
So you both did you both play the WPT?
Yes.
And how did you fare in that? Did you come in 12th into that as well?
Almost. I came in 25th.
Okay.
There's 400 some players, and I was pretty top of 10 chips after day one, take two, and three, so I was doing real well the whole tournament, and kind of got a little unlucky on day four, where we were down 27 people, and I was probably 10th in chips, and ran into some unlucky spots. Actually, Alan says one of the spots I could have avoided, but I don't think I would say anybody else but yourself would have avoided that spot.
I think a couple people.
I had 60 blinds. The average stack was around 50 blinds with 27 people left in the Bellagio 10K.
Yeah.
And I opened the cutoff. A guy I'd never seen before had no information on 3-bet from a small blind. He only had 20 blinds total, and I had 2 tens. So I got it in with him. I shipped it, and he called a he tag called with two jacks. But Alan seems to think that that one could have been avoided. I could have just folded the two tens there against a 20-blind stack, which I definitely wish I did from results perspective, and but from a theoretical perspective, I'm kind of on the fence. Like, I definitely see Alan's point. He basically made a point that I don't want to get too deep into because it let out Alan's secrets, but he thinks that it's pretty strong for a 20-blind stack to 3-bet. In that spot, the 27 left in the tournament, and knowing that it's easy for me to put the money in with them with when I have 60 blinds. So anyway, so I ran tens into jacks there, one orbit, just one orbit later, guy shoves early with 10 blinds, so I call him the cutoff with two nines, and he turns over two tens. So now I got to tell tens versus jacks and nines versus tens versus two short stacks, and now I'm down to 30 blinds, and in about another half an hour, I work it back up to 50 blinds where I'm a little above average stack again, and I pick up two kings, and I got to my left, picks up two aces, and that was all she wrote. So that was three pairs under pairs with one notch underneath the other, and for like an hour and a half period, and that was the end of me for that event. So it's kind of a little unlucky there.
What was your rationale I guess you would have let go of the tens. Is that what you would have done?
I mean, I just don't think that an average person is going to 3-bet fold the 20-blind stack.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think he's going to be... I think if he has, like, two nines or two eights, he's just going to shove. He's not going to, like, 3-bet and then call. So I think when he 3-bets, he's got, like, the absolute top of his value range, which would be crushing tens.
Right. You think so?
I mean, to be honest, I think jacks would be in a nice spot there, but I don't know what I'd do with jacks. I might fold jacks too. He would have gotten me to fold that chop, but I think I'm going to fold the jack. And that's because I've seen it before. I read a lot of updates. I see a lot of hands in tournaments, and I just see how if it's a young kid, you know, like a young kid is known, it's totally different because they might be like leveling you to, you know, make it seem like they have a bigger hand than they actually do when they're getting in,
but who was this person?
Someone I've never seen before. I just got him up to the table. We redraw every table from 45 players down, so now we drew a 36.
I think that's silly.
So it makes it more random. The table draw is not as much of a factor as, you know, it's not as much of a luck factor as a normal tournament because you're redrawing every new table, but you also don't have the information that you have on the players in the normal tournament.
You don't have time to like information. Build a dynamic or do anything else. It kind of ruins the whole game.
It was a player that is either European or South American. He had some kind of accent I wasn't familiar with. And he was probably mid-40s with long hair. But, you know, I have no information, so I don't know if he's an internet player or, you know, a tight middle-aged guy. Who knows? But you know, everything's re-dependent. Alan would say, you know, it depends who it is. Like a young kid, he's never fallen the two tens there. But to an older guy who he doesn't know, he's probably more likely to fall the two tens. She has a valid point.
And how did you fare in the same tournament?
I made it to day two, and then I busted probably with about 45 minutes left in the day. Nothing too exciting. I made one questionable bluff. And then besides that, I played really well. Just was pretty card dead. And watched a bunch of idiots all around me play terribly.
All right.
That perked Marco up when you said a bunch of idiots. He loves that.
And then it's Sean Lee who gets out of line. So you guys are going to have to help me here. I'm a little confused. I have not had a chance to research the matter too carefully. There was some controversy at this event. Much of it, a lot of anger, a lot of players were angry at the Bellagio. That didn't have to do, I think part of it might have had to do with payout structures. Was that part of the the controversy?
There was many, many issues.
Okay.
You can take this one.
Yeah, please.
Okay. A, I've had issues with Bellagio for the past 2 or 3 years.
Okay.
About, I don't know when it was, I think it was about 2 years ago, they decided, whatever, I don't care, I'm never playing there again. Jack McClellan.
You're never playing. That's an
easy bet to win.
Exclusive.
No, I'm serious. I'm never going to play a Bellagio.
Well, okay. Let's take it from the beginning if we may.
I will be playing a Bellagio again many times. Just so
that. Matt Glantz, the views expressed by Alan Bari do not reflect the
So, Jack McClellan is an idiot. Okay. 2 years ago, or maybe 2.5 years ago, they had a couple 1K rebuys, and during a series of events, and they got a good turnout, obviously, because people like 1K rebuys occasionally mixed into the mix.
Mm-hmm.
So Jack McClellan, the genius that he is, decided that he is going to make the next series of tournaments all 1K rebuys. And the average 1K rebuy ran a poker player about $4,000 or $5,000. Mm-hmm. And his rationale was that, oh, someone wants to play a 1K tournament can play a 1K tournament, and everyone else can play a 5K tournament if they want. But the poker community can't sustain itself if, you know, like, you can't just have 5K tournaments every day. And obviously everyone complained. And Scott Clements, who's a very reasonable poker player, signed a petition, got a petition signed to try and turn it around, and Jack, like, didn't even look at it. And then I think, like, maybe a week or two into that Bellagio series, he realized that he wasn't getting the numbers, and he changed the schedule a little bit. But I actually know someone who went up to Jack and said, "Hey, Jack, no one's really showing up to the tournaments. Maybe you should have listened to that petition." And Jack just goes, "I'm not forcing anyone to come here." Which is a really great really great thing to say as a tournament.
Did he actually say this?
Yeah, he actually said that.
When? Like on record or?
Not on record, 2.5 years ago.
Okay.
But, that was an issue. And then that's always been an issue. I hate the valet at Bellagio. But just a side note, okay? They, I don't care how many cars are waiting, they literally take at least 15 to 20 minutes. And this one time I paid a woman to hold my car outside. I was like, "I'll be right back in 15 minutes. Can you just hold it outside?" I gave her $20. Mm. I come back and my car is not there.
Mm.
And I was like, "What the fuck is this? I told you to put my car there." And she was like, "Oh, I'm sorry. We're just really busy." And I look at line there and there's no one even there. They're not busy at all.
Did you get the $20 back?
No. I wanted to ask for it back. What am I supposed to do? But,
So you're of the feeling that Bellagio is not very much in tune with the
right.
players' wants and
well,
demands.
I'll tell you what happened this tournament. They used to have the Fontana Lounge, which was awesome. You know, like they would have their tournaments there, and it was secluded, and you know, people could come watch if they wanted. But now, I guess the bank bought it or something. I don't know what's going on, and they're like turning it into a lounge, which is understandable because that the view of the fountain and that balcony is like just absurd.
Right.
Like, they should have, they can make a lot of money off of that.
Right.
Anyways, so they put us in the middle of the casino. Like, we have slots around our poker tables, and there's people, like, there's a million people watching us smoking cigarettes, blowing into our face. And it's just, like, loud, and it's smoky, and the reason why a lot of poker players started playing poker because there wasn't smoking allowed in poker rooms. So that's issue one. Issue two is the payout system. Which, if you get over 400 players, they pay out 100, which is just insane. They pretty much just gave away $500,000 that they shouldn't have. Not only that, but a min cash is $11,900 on a $10,000 buy-in.
Okay.
What else? What else did they fuck up? 20 minutes left in the night, they deal out for to see how many hands are left in the night, as opposed to 10 minutes.
Mm.
Well, that's... On day three, they decided to change that.
Huh.
Arbitrarily.
Wow.
We went down to 10 minutes.
Which, that's fucked up, too.
It was very fucked up.
Yes. You should keep it consistent, at least, as stupid as it is.
Yes.
So, this is the conclusion that I've come to. I think Jack is sitting in a room at the beginning when he's making this whole, all these decisions, and he's given a checklist of like, decisions, and he is checking every single wrong box just to see how... We like just to see if anyone will do anything because he's had this job forever. Clearly, no one's ever going to do anything because no one is not going to play at Bellagio. Even Matt is going to keep playing at Bellagio.
Right.
And like people are playing their 5Ks. Like, why are you even going to play a 5K at Bellagio? Why are you supporting them? What's the point in supporting them when they don't listen to anything we said? Any other tournament, like you went to Jacksonville. How was it there? Like, they were really they listened to the players, right?
Jacksonville, the crew there, who's formerly from Venetian over here, really did a fine job listening to the players and trying to make every player as happy as possible while they were down there.
Mm-hmm.
It was a new experience for us. It's a very pleasant experience.
I mean, okay, so you're saying us in an effort to, not even just to protest, but just because as a poker player you were so inconvenienced by
right.
you know these measures they're taking or the measures they're not taking, you would not give your business
yeah.
to the Bellagio poker. How widespread is a sentiment like that Because you've also said like, oh, no one is not going to play at the Bellagio. Is that really the kind of community that this is? Just to play, just to, you know, get the EV or get the value out of this tournament, because Bellagio does offer some pretty big tournaments.
Right.
Just to get that, that the community will put up with these. With these things?
Yeah, I mean, I know people that played the 5K that went on yesterday, I guess it was Sunday, and I told, like, these are the same people that were complaining about how terrible the Bellagio tournament was run, but the poker players in general are very selfish and very lazy, so we'll never be able to do anything to stop the Bellagio from, you know, doing whatever they want, but supposedly Sean Deeb said that they're adjusting the payouts.
Jack did claim that they're going to adjust it for next year to make the players happier, because enough people complain that 25% payout of the field is ridiculous. And they've been doing it for the last couple of years, and the uproar has been a little bit more each year. And now this year, there was a lot of twittering and people complaining to Jack personally. And let me just say, what Alan's saying about Bellagio, a lot of it is not in the best interest of the professional poker players, and people are upset, but certainly Bellagio is not Foxwoods. Foxwoods is by far the worst venue.
I want to learn more about why Foxwoods is the worst venue. Before we can get to that, I understand we just recently started, but we do have to take a very, very, very short break. I beg your patience. Please prepare your scathing.
I got a good story about Foxwoods. I actually have two good stories.
And polish that one. We'll be right back. Just a moment. Here we are back. Thank you all for waiting. All right. We were just talking about... By the way, in case you're just tuning in, we are joined live in studio by Alan Bari and Matt Glantz. The topic of the day is shitty casinos, or casinos that run poor tournaments and frustrate poker players, such as those we have present with us today. Now, just before we took that very, very small break, you, Matt, were saying, we were talking about Bellagio and how much it falls short on poker players' expectations, but you said, but it's nothing compared to Foxwoods. What do you mean by that, sir?
Well, let me first say that Bellagio is a nice casino.
Mm-hmm.
It's a nice place to be.
No, it's not.
Jack McClellan is a super nice guy, and he's always been very attentive. If I've ever had problems or asked him to change something, he's always been attentive. But we don't know, Alan and I and other players don't know what goes into his decision-making. He might not be able to make the decisions like to have the tournament out in the slot machine lounge. He might, you know, things are out of his control, so you can't really just blame him. As far as the payout structure, you assume it's his decision to be made, but we don't know that it's not someone over his head says we want it.
Real quick, sorry to interrupt. Let me quote Dan O'Brien. I was just searching for this. Dan O'Brien, another very, very reasonable poker player,
mm-hmm.
tweeted, I believe this is day one, just told Jack McClellan, all the players were rooting to stay under 400 and avoid the 100 payout. He acted like I was the only one he'd heard that from, brushed me off with 10 thank yous, and then gave the policy credit for them having 400 instead of 200 runners. So he's pretty much, Jack was saying, oh, if we didn't do that, there would only be 200 people playing here today. And then he hashtagged Dreamworld, hashtag Brickwall. Dan O'Brien.
So most of the players feel that the Bellagio has been very stubborn in the last couple of years with not changing the payout structure.
Mm-hmm.
Because as it is right now, I believe if there's 399 or under runners in the tournament, they're going to pay out 36 spots. And once we hit 400 runners, they're going to pay out 100 spots, which totally skews the prize pool. Like for instance, I came in 25th place. I cashed for 24,000. If someone who came in 100th place cashed for 12,000. So the scale from 100th place down to 25th was another 12,000.
I think David Williams, who got 10th, got 40,000.
Yeah.
Out of 400 people, he got 10th, and he got 40,000.
It's a little ridiculous.
That's insane.
But you guys are going to have to bear with me, because I'm not a professional poker player. And I understand what the difference are between having an extended prize pool as opposed to having a more concentrated one. But as poker players, why do you care more about fewer people getting paid out, but with more money, as opposed to more people getting paid out with less money? What is the argument there? What is the big benefit?
Well, there has to be an optimal level, right? Whether they pay out 5% of the field or 25%, there's got to be some optimal level. It's certainly a subjective opinion based on whether you're a professional poker player or an amateur player.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems to be the standard in the industry to pay out somewhere between, I guess, 8 and 14% of the field,
mm-hmm.
and that pretty much is the standard, and people, and nobody really complains. Everybody's pretty comfortable with all that. Certainly the professionals, the best professionals, rather than just be out 5% of the field, but they realize that it wouldn't be as good for poker, and you lose people that want to play, and, you know, a better chance just to cash the amateurs and
slow. So the professionals prefer, you know, a shorter percentage because they know they are more likely to make it farther into the tournament.
Correct.
Whereas an extended one caters more to the recreational or amateurs who are just like, well, I just want to cash.
Even an amateur won't care about it. I mean, they're costing $1,900. It's just insane. Like,
casino's perspective, they want to cash as many as possible. So they want to cash. They want 25% to cash, which is what the Blasio did. But the industry standard is between 8% and 14%, and people seem to be happy. So why would the Blasio be so stubborn as to make it 25%? Just
25%. That seems pretty wildly in excess of the 14%.
From my experience, the Blasio and Foxwoods are the only two places that have their own set of rules.
Mm-hmm.
That are different from every other casino in the country and in the world, and they want to stick to them, whether they're better or worse than the rules outside. They think these are our rules, and we want to stick to them.
So what happens at Foxwoods?
Foxwoods is way worse than Bellagio. No matter what Alan could say.
No, I agree.
and that's universal sentiment. I probably won't be going back there, even though I can drive there from my house. It's only 4 hours away, and it's nice to be able to drive to a tournament, but it's so poorly run until they realize, and even the poker room's poorly run. They've driven the high limit cash games out of there. They used to have a lot of high limit games years ago. They have none of that now. They lose their games to the Mohegan. The tournaments don't get any players. They had the 10,000 WPT there last or 2 months ago. How many did they get? Did they get under 100 players?
No, they more than
120 or something.
I don't know, to be honest.
They had the lowest on the World Poker Tour for $10,000 of anywhere, and it's Foxwoods, which is a 2 hour drive from New York City, and then whatever, an hour and a half drive from Boston or something. So it's the most populated area in the country, and they only got 124. I don't know how many players they got for a 10K event.
So frustrations.
They should be ashamed, and the reason it's not because people don't want to go to Foxwoods, it's because people don't want to deal with what they have to deal with when they go there. The place isn't the nicest place to stay, but we can overlook that if the tournament directors and the poker room managers were more friendly to the players.
Mm-hmm.
They have a lot of rules and policies that basically, if there's something that a player, like if I found a problem with a tournament policy at the Borgata, let's say,
mm-hmm.
and I went to the tournament director, which is Tad, and I said, look, we need to fix this. And right away he's going to say, okay, let me look into it. I'm going to get back to you. I'm going to look into this and see what's wrong. If I did the same thing at Foxwoods, and I did during this last tournament 2 months ago, there was a problem. I'm trying to remember. I think it had to do with the sample with how many hands were in play at the end of the night. Arbitrarily, with 15 minutes to go, they decided to count the number of hands we're playing at the end of the night. So I went to the tournament director and I said, you know, why do you guys do this? It's 10 minutes everywhere around the circuit. Why is it arbitrarily 15 minutes? I don't see it anywhere on the rules. Why would you do that? Like, what makes that the decision? He looked at me and said, that's the way we do it. So, you know, you get those kind of answers from the people of Fox. They don't want to deal with players' opinions. And the players are who you have to cater to. So, it's a very poor business idea, the way they're running things.
And the players, though, you know, many players seem to be taking a stand. They're like, well, no, I just prefer not to play there. So there is some possibility of, I don't want to use the word boycott, but refusal to continue lending one's business to.
Look at their entries for the $10,000 event at Foxwoods over the last 8 years. I'm mm-hmm. sure it peaked at some point, probably five, 6 years ago, and went down every single year.
I think it was over 1,000 at one point for Foxwoods.
There may have been 700 or 800 players at one point.
Yeah, I think it was probably 800.
But it's gone significantly down, a significant percentage every single year. I wonder why. It's not that hard to figure out.
So what is.